any examples of kernels and regions we saw up till now? The kernel and regions were always subspaces. The null space and column space of some matrix, full vector of space or some span. Question, are they always subspaces or was it just a coincidence? That's what you will learn in this video. So, are kernel and range always subspaces? Well, you need a linear transformation. If T from V to W is a linear transformation, then the kernel of T is a subspace of V and the range of T is a subspace of W. And, well, let's just refresh what the subspace was. Well, subspace is a non-empty subset H of V, so you need a subset and it needs to be non-empty. And it's a subspace of V if for all U and V in your subspace and for all the scalars C, you also need that U plus C times V is also in your subset H. So, notice that linearity is required. If you take, for example, the transformation from R to R, if of x equals x squared minus 1, saw it already in an earlier video, then the kernel just consists of the point minus 1 and 1, that's not a subspace, and the range also sets of numbers from minus 1 up to infinity, and that's also not a subspace of R. So you really need linearity. If you don't have linearity, then this is in general not true. But why is it true if your transformation is linear? Well, let us look at the kernel first. Kernel of T, definition, is the set of all U in the domain V such that T of U equals 0. Well, we have a subspace if, first of all, the kernel has to be a subset of V. Well, that's true by definition. Then it has to be non-empty. Now, we know that the zero vector is in the domain because we have a transformation from V to W. Zero is V is double V is vector space, so zero is always in there. We know that T is linear, so the T from zero is zero. So that means that we have at least one vector, a zero vector, which is mapped to zero. That means that the kernel is not empty. There's at least one vector in it, namely the zero vector, because that one is already mapped to a zero vector. So we have now a non-empty subset of V. But do you also satisfy this last condition over here? Well, let's try. Take two vectors U and V in the kernel of T, and you know that T of U and T of V are both equal to zero. Then you have to show that U plus C times V is also in the kernel. Take the T of U plus C times V. Now we can use that we have a linear transformation. That's T of U plus C times T of V equals zero plus C times zero equals zero. So indeed, if U and V are in the kernel, then U plus C times V is also in the kernel. So this last condition is also satisfied, which means that our kernel is a subspace of V. Then for the range, now remember what the range was, the range of T as a set of all Y in W such that T of x equals y for some x in V, so set of y's that you can actually reach by some x in the domain. Well, first of all, your range, is it a subset of W? Yes, by definition, so it's a subset. Is it non-empty? Well, we have that, again, T of 0 equals 0, because the same reason as we had over here. That means that your zero vector is automatically also in the range because you can reach it by the zero vector which is in your domain. So non-empty, that's also okay. And then we have to show that if you have some y1 and y2 in the range, do you also know that y1 plus c times y2 is also in the range? Well, because y1 and y2 are in the range, by assumption, you know that there are x1 and x2 in V such that T of x1 equals y1 and T of x2 equals y2. But V is a vector space, so that means if x1 and x2 are in V, then the vector x1 plus c times x2 is also in V. And if you now compute the t of x1 plus c times x2, you get the t of x1 plus c times the t of x2 equals y1 plus c times the y2. So that means that you can indeed reach your y1 plus c times y2 by the factor x1 plus c times x2. So you can reach y1 plus c times y2, which means that the last property is also satisfied. So you see that the range of t is also a subspace. So if you have a linear transformation, then both your kernel and your range are subspaces of your domain and your codomain.